fixing a decision made by the previous administration to create confusion across the country on where federal jurisdiction begins and ends. That doesn't do anybody. In fact, it doesn't improve the environment. How do we know that? Where 31 states sued the EPA to halt the implementation of that new definition. It never took place. And then those across the country said, okay, what's governing our conduct here? We have to get a permit as we use our land. And so it just created all this confusion and uncertainty because an agency in the first instance did what? Took a statute and says, we're going to do something more than what the statute permits. We're going to do something more than what history has shown. We're going to reimagine authority and then take a very aggressive posture. And that created this this state of confusion and uncertainty across the country. So Harry, I just want to echo that this ultimately is about clean water. So that states and the EPA can work collaboratively in partnership, each within our jurisdiction, to ensure outcomes that are consistent with water quality that are set by the states.gov, as you know. So this is something that is desperately needed. It's not just making the old rule go away. It's the second step, and I like to emphasize that. It's the next step of what? Making sure we get the definition right. The timing on that is going to be no later than the first quarter of next year. We've already started the process in earnest. This federalism discussion we're having here with states is meant to inform that. And so we're making a record now, and the rule will be finalized in the first quarter of 2015.
Washington is good at naming things that have nothing to do with what they're talking about. Waters of the USA has got nothing to do with clean air and clean water. We're all for that. It's about developing land. It's about micromanaging development. It's about extending the role and the scope of the federal government. That you literally need their permission to build a fence or dig a ditch or develop property or to farm. Count me in for clean air and clean water. Scott, if you know South Carolina well, God dealt us a good hand in terms of a beautiful place to live. We're all committed to keeping it beautiful for the next generations. But Hugh is the most active agriculture commissioner in the world because he calls me all the time about stuff I didn't know about.
And you don't know what I call you.
Yeah. And probably with good reason. Bottom line, he's very active in getting this meeting today at a typical family farm in South Carolina.
Yeah,
we'll do a lot to advance our cause. So I just end with this, Scott. You coming here today says more about the Trump administration's efforts to make America great again and work again than anything I could think of. Having the EPA administrator come to a very rural part of South Carolina to listen is a giant step forward. Congratulations.
Administrator, Commissioner, thank you so much for putting this together. Karen and Jim, thank you for your hospitality. To me, it's a dream come true. 20 years ago, I was a real estate attorney. And I had Glenn Shannon and Rusty Shannon from downtown Sandy Run, Harry Ott's community, come to me and explain that they were in a fight about a navigable stream. And they were trying to build a little dam. And it was a periodic, intermittent water flow. And after a great deal of effort, because I thought navigable stream meant boat, I even gave credit for a canoe. It was nothing. This needs to be changed on behalf of so many of the home builders here who create jobs and opportunities for the people of South Carolina. I want to thank you. And again, it's just grateful to be back in Orangeburg, Calhoun, where my introduction to this began. And I'm also grateful to introduce the next person, the Attorney General of South Carolina, Alan Wilson, who is a dear friend of our of the administrator. And so over the past couple of months, Your ears would have burned by the great things that Attorney General Alan Wilson has said about you. Alan Wilson.
Thank you. Thank you, Congressman. I've enjoyed the 40-year working relationship. Decades working with him to make South Carolina a great place to live, work, and raise a family. And Senator Graham, I want to go ahead and take one thing that, that Commissioner Weathers and you mentioned earlier. Senator Graham is easy to reach. And I've called him a number of times on his cell phone about any number of issues, and he's always there to pick up the phone. And it's
great. Never given my number out.
I never given his number out. Thank you for your leadership in the Senate, and you thank you so much, Mr. Commissioner, for having us here. And the first WOTUS rule, when it came out, Administrator Pruitt and a number of other AGs and I, we took great exception because it injected a great deal of complexity into the market, as many of you already know, and it injected a great deal of uncertainty. And the thing is you have to account for the cost of complexity and uncertainty when you don't know how something's going to affect you. Whether that pond out there is going to end up being a water of the U.S. because a cow is drinking out of it, and that cow gets slaughtered and then sent across state lines. I mean, where does water of the U.S. line stop? And when you have to account for that uncertainty, that cost has to be borne by somebody. It has to get passed down the chain to the consumer, to the citizens of our communities and our states. And so for people who don't think WOTUS affects them, it affects everybody. If you drive a car, if you eat, if you live in a house, you're affected by this WOTUS rule. So Administrator Pruitt, I'm very grateful to have you here. And I'll close with this. A little joke that kind of emerged with the AGs during this last 2 years is that we didn't really call it the WOTUS rule, we called it the LOTUS rule, because it was a land of the U.S., because what it basically sought to do was co-opt the lands of many of you and many of your members, the people you represent, and it basically took their land from them through regulatory fiat. And that is why I'm glad that we are going to have a rule that involves cooperative federalism, partnership with the states and the stakeholders at the table, where we get to feed our information up the chain to the EPA, and they get to take a rule into account that balances all of our interests while protecting the environment and preventing polluters from hurting it. And I appreciate you allowing this opportunity, Mr. District.